Well, good evening, and thank you all for coming out in the snow to hear me talk about someone that I've been very much involved with for many years. And I want to thank Vintage and the Tenement Museum and the East Side Conservancy for making this possible. On March 1st, 1944, just a few days before he was caught by the Gestapo, Emanuel Ringelblum wrote one of his final letters to a friend of his, Mr. Berman, Otto Berman. And he asks in this letter, he says, if we're caught, if you're caught, if I'm caught, what will happen to our archive? What will happen to the Oynik Shabbos? The Oynik Shabbos, which in Yiddish is joy of the Sabbath, in Hebrew it's Oynik Shabbat, this was their code word that they used to help preserve secrecy. They would refer to it as the OS. And miraculously, the Germans never discovered the secret. But Ringelblum is asking, if we're caught, what will happen to the Oynik Shabbos? And he had very good reason to worry because of the 60 or so collaborators that Emanuel Ringelblum brought together in the Warsaw Ghetto to work on this important project of documentation. There were only three survivors. And only one, Hirsch Wasser, knew where the archive had been buried. Wasser himself survived by the slimmest of margins, once jumping from a train, taking him to Treblinka. And after the war, he and his wife and Rachel Auerbach, the three who survived, begged, implored, pleaded with everybody they met to search for the archive, which was buried under the ruins of Novolipki 68, a former Yiddish school. But anyone who's seen a picture of Warsaw in 1945 and 1946 knows that it was such an ocean of ruins that sometimes it was hard to even know where a street had been, much less a building. But using aerial photographs, using a surviving steeple from a Catholic church to estimate distances, using surveyors and engineers, they went on this archaeological quest. And on September 18th, 1946, the searchers found the first of 10 tin boxes in the basement of Novolipki 68. And Wasser said, we buried a lot more. I mean, this isn't very much. There's a lot more, but they looked and looked and they couldn't find anything else. And then 4 years later, in December 1950, Polish construction workers building new apartment buildings came across two aluminum milk cans. The tin boxes had been buried in August 1942. They covered the period from 1940 to 1942, August 42. The two aluminum milk cans found nearby in 1950 covered the period from August 42 until February 43, the so-called second cache. And Wasser and others said, well, there's still a third cache. Just before the Battle of the Warsaw Ghetto, we buried more documents under the brushmaker's factory, Świętajerska 34. And over time, that became the site of the Chinese embassy in Poland. And not so long ago, Israeli searchers went up to the Chinese and said, listen, we want to dig under your embassy and look for the missing part of the Ringelblum archive. The Chinese said, okay, but they didn't find anything. So much of what was buried was never found. Nevertheless, we have about 25 to 30,000 documents. And why is this important? Well, the title of my book, Who Will Write Our History? That's the question, and that's why this project was important. The Germans thought that they were going to win the war, they would write the history, they would determine how posterity would remember the Jews. And if you have any questions about how the Germans intended for the Jews to be remembered, just look at Nazi propaganda films like the Ewige Jude, which compare Jews to rats. And Jews in the ghettos said, no, even if we die, we will leave documents. Even if we die, we will leave time capsules. So future generations will remember us on the basis of our sources, of Jewish sources. To write in those conditions was a great act of optimism. It was to say that Hitler will lose the war. Because if you didn't believe with all your heart that Hitler was going to lose, then what was the point of leaving these time capsules? And keep in mind that most Polish Jews went to their deaths in 1942, when for most of that year the Germans were winning. They were on the Volga. They were close to Alexandria. It looked as if they were winning the war. And yet these people believed with all their heart that Hitler would lose and that someday these time capsules would be uncovered. In other words, Jews resisted not only with guns, but Jews also resisted with paper and with pen. The elderly Jewish historian, the dean of Jewish historians in Eastern Europe, Shimon Dubnow, is reported to have cried as he was being led to his execution in the Riga ghetto, Yidden verschreibt, Jews, write it all down. In the ruins of crematoria number 3 or 2 in Auschwitz-Birkenau, we found glass bottles stuffed with writings of members of the Sonderkommando, the group that emptied the gas chambers. In the Vilna ghetto, we found the diary of Hermann Krug. There were secret archives in other ghettos, archives in the Lodz ghetto, in the Vilna ghetto. The Oinik Shabbos was the biggest of all these archives, perhaps the biggest underground project of documentation in all of occupied Europe. It was the biggest in terms of its organization. Ringelblum brought together, as I said, 60 people, rabbis like Shimon Huberbaum, communists like Yehuda Feld, women like Rachel Auerbach, well-known people like Lippe Bloch, head of the Zionist fundraising in Poland, totally unknowns like a young man, Daniel Fliegelman, who arrived as a refugee in the Warsaw Ghetto. The famous and the not so famous all worked together in a common cause. The archive was also very well organized. There was an executive committee that would meet every Saturday afternoon and chart the tasks that had to be done. There were secretaries that made copies of the documents. They tried to make 2 or 3 copies of every document. They didn't have Xerox machines. Then there were the interviewers. Now, to be an interviewer for the Oinik Shabbos was not like being an interviewer here in New York City. It meant going into the refugee centers where the Germans had dumped up to 100,000 refugees from provincial towns, and Jews living 2,000 to 3,000 to 4,000 in former synagogues and former schools, covered with lice, infected with typhus, and risking their own lives, these interviewers went and talked to these people and got information on what was going on. Many of them came down with typhus. Some of them died of the disease, but they kept at their work. Then there was a technical staff, Israel Lichtenstein and two teenage boys, who had physical custody of the documents. Only they knew where the documents were, so there was kind of a firewall. So if someone were caught by the Germans, that person would not be able to betray the location of the archive. The Oinik Shabbos differed from the other underground archives as well in the very ambition of its agenda, its changing agendas.